Hey guys, so this is going to be our demo of the basics of JavaScript. What we're going to go through is connecting our JavaScript file to our HTML file and then saying hello, aka console.log. And then we're going to look at what are certain data types. We're going to talk about the DOM a little bit. We're going to talk about selectors and events. And we're going to talk about functions and conditionals at the end. Cool. Let's do it. So, as usual, we start with our ID. And here I'm using Atom, and I'm going to create a new file, which is going to be my index.html file. So the first thing that I do is I save it, and then I'm going to make a new folder called conlab2. And inside it, I'm going to create index.html. Sweet. And I'm going to do my basic HTML boilerplate. So I have my HTML tag, my head tag, my body tag, all good. In my title, I'm going to say conlab.js demo. Sweet. I click on the folder in which I saved it. I open it. And I have an empty browser. So far, so good, because I have an empty body right here. So let's start by saying hello. I save it, I refresh, and now I see hello. All good, everything works. So JavaScript is an actual scripting language, and that scripting language exists in a separate file from the HTML. If you remember from the CSS, we had to link the CSS file in our head tag. This is what we're going to do with our JavaScript file. So if you want to link a JavaScript file, the first thing we need is a JavaScript file. So we're going to go to File, New File, and save it immediately. And this time, I'm going to call it script.js. Cool. We have an empty script.js. This is going to be the file where we're going to write all of our JavaScript, which then is going to affect our HTML. And now, to connect the JavaScript file, I'm going to add a specific tag called script. And script takes one argument called src, which is similar to the image tag. It's basically, where should we find the script? And we can find it at script.js. Cool. We don't need to put anything inside. We just need to say, hey, you're going to include some script, and you're going to include some script that's in the file script.js. And script.js is in our folder here. Okay. I refresh, nothing happens. And so that's kind of the problem with programming languages in general, is that by default, they don't show us what they're doing, right? And so we need a way to actually see what's going on in our program. The most basic thing in JavaScript to see what is going on is console.log with a message inside the parentheses saying hello there. Okay, and we add a semicolon at the end. JavaScript doesn't require us to add semicolons, so sometimes we forget, sometimes we don't forget. It's good practice to put semicolons, because other programming languages that you will learn in the future more often than not require semicolons. I might forget them though. So we have this script, and this is essentially saying, hey, write a message that says hello there. So we're going to go back, we're going to refresh, no difference, right? So the JavaScript doesn't actually show explicitly inside our window. And shows in this special space called the console. The console, we looked at it a little bit when we looked at the structure of an HTML element in the previous lectures. So we're going to go here in the menu, and then we're going to go to Web Developer, and we're going to go to Web Console. And now, whoa, crazy. Here it is. Hello there. And it says, look at what this did. From this file, script.js, on line number one. Amazing. Cool. This means that our index.html has loaded this script. And then inside the script, we have one line that says, in the console, write hello there. So far, so good. I can say hello again, save it, refresh it, bam, hello again. So our HTML and our JavaScript are talking to each other. Beautiful. That covers the groundwork. There are two very important things in programming, and we talked about these in the lecture a little bit already. But the first one is data types, aka variables. So variables are basically containers in which we can put any kind of data. And you remember the way that we manipulate variables is first by declaring. So we're going to say, let my variable, okay, and then initializing, where we give it a value, and we say, what can we say? Wow, lack of inspiration for writing a word. Lack of inspiration. And then we use it. How would we use it? In this case, we could say inside console.log, instead of printing this particular message, we want to print my variable. Okay, I save it, I refresh, and now we see lack of inspiration. Great. And so what you see now is that we can change what is being shown in this console, so what the script is doing, without actually changing this line. We can say plenty of inspiration, and then reload it, and we have plenty of inspiration. We can also say 2046, and refresh it, and we see 2046. And so now you realize a couple of things that change in terms of colors. This is green, right? Before it was white. This is orange, and before it was green, right? And so these are data types. Back in the day, computers used to run in a way that needed to know exactly what kind of data you gave them. So data such as numbers, such as single characters, such as words, or such as booleans. Booleans are values that are only true or false. Words, the real name is actually string, because there are strings of characters. Okay, so these are going to be the most important data types that we're going to use. And actually, we're not going to use single characters for now. There are other classes where you might end up using single characters. But for now, let's just deal with numbers, strings, and booleans. Okay, numbers are orange, strings are green. Booleans are orange again. Okay. And it's either true or false. Okay. So we have these three data types. That's not super interesting though, is it? Right? We can write some things here, but we don't want to have our visitors like end up opening the console and have to look at this and read it and blah, blah. I mean, some websites do it just for fun, but we want to be able to manipulate what's going on in there, in the actual DOM. So what's the DOM again? The DOM is basically the structure of the whole HTML page. It's the document object model. Okay, so if we want to modify what's going on this page, we need to modify the DOM. And to do that, we can do it in JavaScript by writing document. See, it becomes red, so JavaScript knows, yeah, now you want to mess with the document, we can mess with the document. But what do we do, right? Maybe we do this. Maybe we say, document, inside the document, give me the body, right? It's this tag. And we can just say body like this, because JavaScript knows that any HTML page is going to have a body tag. So we can just say straight up body. And then what do we want to change with the body? Maybe we want to change what it looks like. So we want to change the CSS. And we can do that by saying document.body.style. And what are some interesting CSS attributes we could change? Let's say like color, right? So we change the color of our text that is displayed on the body. And we're going to put it as orange. Okay, so when we refresh, the JavaScript is going to run. It's going to initialize this variable, give it a value. It's going to print it to the console. And then it's going to find the document, find the body, access the style of the body, find what color is currently set, and say, now the color is orange. Go back. Refresh. Woohoo! This guy's orange now. Okay, so JavaScript allows us to manipulate document elements. But what if we want to have one single element we want to change? Because right now we're changing everything, right? So any other thing that I write here, like another paragraph, this other paragraph, I refresh it, the other paragraph is still orange. Okay? What if I just want to have one single word that is orange? Okay? Or rather, let's say we put our hello inside our paragraph. And we only want to have this other paragraph that turns orange, okay? And so we need a way to select a specific p tag. And you remember in CSS, we were doing things like class, right? Class equals the paragraph, or class equals button, and then we can access that in the CSS. In JavaScript, there's this thing called ID. And ID acts almost the same way as class. We give it a name, and then we can use it inside JavaScript. And we're going to call it orange paragraph. Paragraph. Yay, cool. Okay. So now we're going to change our JavaScript so that instead of saying, hey, we want the whole body to change, we just want the paragraph to change. The first step is getting or finding the desired element. To do that, we say let orange paragraph, because if we find something, we want to store it somewhere, so we're going to store it inside a variable called orange paragraph. And this is where we're going to find through the DOM our specific ID. Document.getElement by ID, which is self-explanatory. It's like, hey, go to the document, find the element with the ID. With which ID? The ID that we put here. And that ID was orange paragraph. It's hard to write, actually. Orange paragraph. Okay. So now we can do things with orange paragraph. Like this variable here is actually going to refer to this whole guy there. Okay. So I'm going to go back to script, and I'm going to say paragraph dot style dot color. Oh, actually, no, orange paragraph. Dot style dot color equals orange. Okay. Again, we create a variable. Inside the variable, we store the result of the document looking for the ID orange paragraph, which is this guy. And then we access the style, we access the color, and we say the color needs to be orange. We reload, and it works. So now the original one, the first one, paragraph, is still black, it's not touching anything. Second one becomes orange. Cool. So we're able to modify something from the DOM by writing some JavaScript code. But for now, it's kind of boring, right? Like, the JavaScript executes and then immediately it creates this, or it finds the orange paragraph and then it sets the style to orange. We could do that for it with CSS. And usually when we want to do something like that, we should probably do it with CSS. So maybe what we want to do instead is make it so that if we click on that particular tag, HTML tag, HTML element, then it becomes orange. Okay, let's see how we do that. This thing here is called a selector. There are a bunch of selectors, and we'll look at it later throughout the semester. But whenever you have get something, 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 that's a selector. You select an element from the HTML. And then once we have that element, we can do something with events. And events is essentially something happens, and we can wait for that thing to happen and say, hey, when that thing happens, do something else. In our case, we're going to wait for our visitor to click on that particular paragraph. And then when the new visitor clicks on the paragraph, we're going to be able to say anything. But specifically, we're going to say, make that paragraph orange. So the way we write this is orange paragraph dot add event listener, right? So there's an event, it's going to be the click event, and we want to listen for that event. We want to pay attention, and then whenever that event happens, we want to be doing something to it. Okay, what's the name of the event? I don't know. What do we do when we don't know? We go to MDN. MDN is the Mozilla Developer Network, and we're going to say HTML events. So we look for this. And we're going to find the event reference from Mozilla. And there's a bunch of events, blah, 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 blah. And we want something like click, right? So transition, reset, submit, no, view, clipboard, key down, key up. Ooh, mouse, click. Cool, mouse event. We click on this, and let's see how they write it. Blah, blah, blah. Details, examples. Yes. Yep. This is what we're doing. Add event listener, click. And we're going to do click. And then what do we want to do when the click happens? we want to make it orange. And when we want to make something, this is when we have to deal with functions. So right now, we're going to write it just like this. Okay, when you have those two parentheses, that's a function. And then inside the curly brackets, this is where we set up what the function does. And what do we want it to do? We want to go to the element, find the style, find the color, and set it to orange. And again, we find the HTML element that's interesting. We add an event listener. We say whenever someone's going to click on you, then listen to it and execute whatever is in that function. And whatever is in that function is changing the color of the event, of the element to orange. Let's see. We refresh, and both black, right? We start, it's okay. Because the only thing we're doing is printing something to the console and then finding our paragraph. That's all there is. And now, let's click on it. Oh, things work out as expected. Crazy, beautiful. But if I click, maybe I want to click and it toggles, right? Okay. Let's see how we could do that. Basically, the idea of a toggle is that we have, we check if something is turned on. If it is turned on, we turn it off. If something is turned off, we turn it on. Simple enough. How we do that with JavaScript is with these things called conditionals. Conditionals work pretty simply. Basically, you say, if something is true, then do X, otherwise do Z. Okay, and it looks like this. If 2 plus 2 is greater than 3, then we're going to say console.log math works. Else, console.log math is broken. And let's delete this guy for now. We refresh, and what do you think is going to happen? We see math works right there. And we don't see math is broken, right? Because what happens is that the if statement, the conditional, says, so 2 plus 2 is equal to 4. Is 4 greater than 3? Yes, it's true. It's this guy here, it's true. And therefore, it's going to execute any code that is going to be between those two curly brackets. So this is why we see math works. And then it's going to skip all the rest. But if we say something like 2 plus 2 is less than 3, now it's 4 is less than 3, right? And so this whole thing is false. It's not true. It's false. Therefore, our conditional, our if statement, is going to skip all of this, and it's going to go in there, and it's going to print this thing. So we refresh, and math is broken. Okay. So now we have a better idea of how conditionals work. In there, we can also use our variables. So remember, we have my variable equals 2046. We could say, if my variable is less than 3, then math works. Otherwise, it's broken. So what are we going to see? Let's check it out. Math is broken because my variable, which has the value 2046, is 2046 smaller than 3? No. So it skips that part, jumps there, and this is where we see math is broken. Okay. So we can use variables inside our if statements. AKA if statements. Sweet. So remember when we're talking about toggling on and off? If something is off, we turn it on. If something is on, we turn it off. Sounds pretty apt to use conditionals there. So let's go back to whenever our visitor has clicked on the button. And we want to say, well, okay, let's check for the color. If orange paragraph dot style dot color equals equals to orange, do something else, do something else. Okay. You might be wondering why we have those two equals there, when here we only have one equal, for instance. That's the difference between assigning and comparing. So in that case, with one equal, I'm saying whatever value is on the right, put it inside the thing on the left. Okay? It's the same here. Whatever value is on the right, whatever thing that you find in the document that has the ID orange paragraph, put it inside our variable called orange paragraph. But here, we don't actually want to like put orange as the value of the color immediately, right? We just want to check. Like, if it's already orange, it's fine. If it's black, maybe we want to change it to orange. We just want to know what's up right now. Like, we want to see what the color is. And in that case, with two equal signs, we're just comparing those. And so the result of all this is either true or false. Whatever value is inside the color of the orange paragraph, if that's orange, then we're going to execute the code here inside the first curly brackets. Otherwise, if it's another value, then we're going to execute the code there. Yep. So what do we do if the orange paragraph is already orange? Then we want to change the color to black, for instance. Otherwise, if it's not orange, which means if we're getting there, then we want to do orange paragraph dot style dot color equals orange. If you're not orange, become orange. If you're already orange, become black. Yep. I go back, I refresh, and then let's see what happens. Oh, orange, black, orange, black. Woo! Woo! Great. It works. So that's kind of cool. We can change the CSS properties, right? So we can like make things appear, make things disappear, make things change color, make things move around. Anything you have in CSS, you can access through the style in JavaScript. But maybe we also want to add some text. Okay. We want to say hello, and then whenever someone clicks on hello, or not even click, you know what? If someone puts their mouse over hello, then we're going to display something. And if someone puts the mouse out of hello, we're going to hide that thing. Okay. So first we need another tag, which is going to be empty. And this is where our like ghost text is going to appear. So we're going to give it an ID so we can use it in JavaScript. We call it ghost text. And then in hello, we also want to use it in JavaScript. So we give it an ID and we say greeting text. Cool. So, what's going to be the process? The process is going to be find that HTML element and then listen for two events. We want to listen for an event when the mouse comes in and listen for an event when the mouse comes out. And then what do we do in those events? We're going to do something with our ghost text. Either we display something or we don't. Let's do it. Let greeting element. Because we're going to find a document element and we want to store it somewhere. Document.get element by ID. And we call it greeting. Greeting what? Greeting text. Greeting text. Greeting text. Sweet. So now we found the greeting text. And now the event listeners. So greeting text dot add event listener. And again, I can't remember all of those event listeners, so let's go back to our MDN documentation. It has to do with mouse, right? So mouse enter. Mouse enter sounds good. A pointing device is moved onto the element that has the listener attached. So it moves onto the element. And then we have mouse leave, which is moving out of the element. And let's see how they write it. Blah, blah, yep. Mouse target, add event listener, mouse enter. So mouse enter. And then we're going to do something. And what do we want to do? We want to display something right here, right inside this ghost text. So we need to find the ghost text and we need to change the content of the ghost text. How do we find it? Document.getElementById ghost text. And now we don't actually need to save it inside a variable, right? If we're just going to do one simple single thing, we can just say, hey, change that to inner text equals I am a ghost. Okay, so go to the document, find the element with the ID ghost text, find the inside text, the inner text of that element, and then set it to the value I am a ghost. Basically, write I am a ghost. Let's see how that goes. We refresh, and paragraph still works. Oh. Nothing works, but we have an error here. Reference error, greeting text is not defined. And it says on line 33, so on this line here, this thing like greeting text, you're talking about this thing, I don't know what it is. Why is that? It's because I made a mistake. Because I called the variable greeting element. And here I'm saying, find this thing called greeting text and add an event listener. So I'm going to replace it with greeting element. Let's refresh. And whoa! The ghost appeared. Crazy. But when I move my mouse out, it still doesn't go out. So this is when we need the second event. We need mouse leave. So we're going to do greeting element dot add event listener mouse leave. And then the function. And we do the same thing. Dot get element by ID ghost text dot inner text equals nothing, as if nothing ever happened. We refresh. Boom. See something. I'm a ghost. Crazy. Okay. It works. When the mouse enters, it sets the inside element to I am a ghost, And when the mouse leaves, it makes him disappear. Sweet. So this whole practice of having variables, finding elements in the DOM via selectors, adding event listeners, such as when someone clicks, or when the mouse of something enters, maybe when you scroll. You also have like they're crazy event listeners. There's one where they can check if your laptop is charging or not. Sometimes if you have like a gyroscope, they can also play with the gyroscope. There's a lot of like far out ones. So what you guys should do right now is create a simple web page with simple interactivity. You go on the event and find something like, a selection has been cut and copied to the clipboard. Can you do something interesting when someone tries to like copy and paste? If any key is pressed, or if any key is released, maybe you can move around. If you press W, then like the whole screen becomes blue. Maybe some text is being selected. What do you want to display when the text is selected? And then there's a bunch of other events, which we're going to look at later throughout the semester. But you have things like whenever a download is happening, whenever a playback of a media element has happened, and so on and so forth. But right now, you guys should look at keyboard events, mouse events, and make something interactive on that symbol webpage. Cool. Okay, actually, I forgot to talk about functions. Because we talked about functions a little bit in the lecture, but now let's see how that can be applied specifically. So maybe we want to have a function that says that always adds some text to an element, right? So we go to line 34, and this is kind of what we want the function to do. We want to find the element, and we want to set the inner text to something specific. Okay, so to do that, we need to declare a function. We need to first, kind of like a variable, we need to say make ghost text appear. That's the name of our function. And then what is going to be the value of our function? It's going to be parentheses, just as specify and define that it's a function, and then we're going to say this is what it does inside this curly brackets. And what does it do? Well, it kind of does that, right? This exact line. So I'm just going to cut it and paste it. Okay. But now if I reload, nothing happens, right? Because we still have the event listener here, and then we say, when the mouse enters, do this thing. What does it do? Nothing. Because we moved all of our functionality inside the function here. And so all we need to do is replace this part with the name of our function. It becomes a little nicer to read, right? The greeting element listens for something, it listens for mouse enter, and then when mouse enter happens, it makes the ghost text appear. We're going to refresh, and woo! It's there! Woo! How would we do it for this? Exact same thing. Let make ghost text disappear equals, oops, space too much. And this is the thing that we want to happen. Find the ghost text, find the text inside, and set it to nothing. And our empty function here, we're going to say make ghost text disappear. And we refresh. Oh, cool. Still works. Works exactly the same. But now it becomes a little bit clearer to read, right? On the one side, you have your event listeners, and it says, when the mouse enter, make the ghost text appear. When it leaves, make the ghost text disappear. We don't actually need to care about how we do it. How do we make it appear? How do we make it disappear? We just know if it enters, it appears. If it leaves, it disappears. Period. And that allows us to change things here without changing the event listener part. So for instance, we could do something like set timeout. And set timeout in JavaScript is a function that does something, but only after a certain amount of time. So in that case, we start with a function, and then we put this inside, because this is what we want it to do. And how long do we want to wait? Let's say we want to wait 500 milliseconds. Okay, so set timeout is a function. You see these like parentheses, arrows, curly brackets? A function that makes the ghost text go blank, but it only happens 500 milliseconds, so half a second after it was supposed to happen. So there's going to be a tiny delay. Let's see what it looks like. We go to hello, and I can move my mouse around before it disappears. Hello. And if we do 5,000 milliseconds, we refresh. The text appears. 2, 3, 4, 5, and now it's gone. So set timeout is very useful for delays and different timings in general. Okay, I'd like you to get back to your exercise. Find the event reference. Find the mouse events. Find the keyboard events. Make something interactive and fun appear on your website with those events.